What's up, YouTube family? We're experiencing the battles of Rogue One, namely, the invasion of Scarif. It has been a while since I've seen the movie, and I cannot wait for its release on Blu-ray. I actually have a theory. I think that we're going to start to see some 4K Star Wars movies pretty soon. The anniversary release of A New Hope is coming this summer. It's actually going to be celebrating its 40th anniversary, so around the time of the Star Wars celebration, I am hoping that we're going to see a 4K restoration of A New Hope, despecialized with none of George Lucas's early 2000s, late 90s edits. At least that's my hope. At the very least, I'm going to say that it's guaranteed we're going to see a despecialized edition of A New Hope. And I guess that'll be good enough for me, but I really want a UHD Blu-ray disc. There are a lot of TIE fighters around here. Let's see if I can take them all out. Damn, that looks beautiful. I think the Battle of Scarif is actually possibly the most exciting scene in terms of battles and wars and action in the Star Wars universe. Maybe not action, because there have been some fantastic lightsaber fights, especially the Duel of Fates in Phantom Menace. And say what you want about Episode 1, say what you want about the Phantom Menace, but the Duel of the Fates is one of the best pieces of Star Wars music we have ever seen. And it was a pretty good duel. Some people say it looked choreographed, but I maintain the fact that this is the Jedi in their prime. So they are going to be dancing around like ballerinas, you know? That is how skilled they are. They can do flips, they can do twists. Oh crap, I almost ran into that blockade runner. Damn, that looks sweet. Hopefully nothing happens to it. Nah, you know what? I bet that blockade runner is going to go right through that shield gate and it's going to spearhead this whole invasion. You go, little blockade runner! I got your back. In fact, we'll give you cover and fire. Shit. I guess not. Scratch that last part. And it's dead. Hopefully we're chosen as a U-Wing. The U-Wings are the only thing that's going to spearhead this invasion. Not blockade runners. Not X-Wings. Not Y-Wings. If we can get a U-Wing through that shield gate, we'll have a chance to get boots on the ground. Anyway, yeah. I like that rule, that duel in Episode 1, but I would say that it's been a while since I've seen Rogue One, so the glow is gone for me, and just looking at the Battle of Scarif objectively, I think it may just be my favorite piece of action in the Star Wars universe. It's fantastic. And it's the cutting edge of CG, too. Disney, obviously, with their enormous sums of money, is leading the CG war, so to speak. I don't think that CG looks better than Disney CG. It's a little iffy in the Marvel movies sometimes. I prefer the CG in the DC movies. I think it's a little more realistic. But when it comes to Star Wars, come on. There is no substitute. It's like Porsche of CG. Speaking of which, The Last Jedi is shaping up to be a fantastic movie from what we can tell. A lot of people are saying it's going to be the darkest of the sequel trilogy, which is what you call the Force Awakens trilogy. It's the sequel trilogy. Just in case some of you guys are wet behind the ears. But we actually have some leaks I want to talk about, and hopefully I can talk about these leaks without getting in legal trouble. I'm assuming I can. It's not going to be any spoilers. It's some basic leaks, some key leaks though. Namely, around some of the set pieces that we may see in The Last Jedi. And this was just released. These are actually going to be Lego sets that are going to be releasing around the same time as The Last Jedi. And if you were following The Force Awakens, you'll know that some of the biggest leaks of The Force Awakens actually came from toy manufacturers like Hasbro. So I would say that Lego may actually have leaked some of the locations of The Last Jedi. And again, I'm not going to be talking about any spoilers in this live stream, because nothing's confirmed for one thing. And for another thing, you would see these Lego sets on shelves. So it's really nothing to do with actual plot spoilers or anything to do with that matter. Even those of you guys that want to go in fresh, I don't think you'll have any surprises here. Are you kidding me? Yo, that blockade runner was twisting around. I just happened to land in its big butt. That really burns me up. Wait a second, we got a U-Wing on approach. I should really be defending these guys. I was being a little selfish, just going after some of these TIE fighters for personal gain, just getting some kills under my belt. And, you know, if the U-Wing doesn't make it through, then I have a chance to make it through as the U-Wing. Those are the dealings of a Sith. Only a Sith would be so selfish. Speaking of which, I actually have some things I want to talk about regarding the Sith, the Death Star, Rogue One, Grand Moff Tarkin, and many other things that I was reading today. Some really interesting stuff, but before we get to that, I want to talk about the Last Jedi leaks. And hopefully succeed with this initial invasion of Scarif. Once we get through this initial space invasion, then we can focus on the ever more important ground invasion. I'm really glad that we saw a decent amount of the space invasion in the movie, though, because we don't have a whole lot of space action in the Star Wars universe, shockingly. It is called Star Wars. We had more space action in the prequel trilogy than we did in the sequel trilogy. I mean, the original trilogy, but... Right, let's take a look at some of these Last Jedi leaks, and then let's take a look at the chat room. But we did get a U-Wing through! Excellent! Once the U-Wing lands, sure shot on Scarif. Poor little X-Wing. He didn't quite make it. Once they land shoreside, we'll have to get some of those cargo ships. Blow one up, make a big diversion. Alright, let me see if I can find my list here. So, here they are. So, the Star Wars sets for The Last Jedi LEGO sets are as follows. Finn's Escape, Karp's Airspeeder, Siege on Mar Harvar. It's alien! You can't expect me to know how to pronounce that. Kylo Ren's Advanced TIE Fighter, and a Resistance Fighter, a First Order Star Destroyer, and Luke's Jedi Temple in Ahch-To. So, looks like some of the rumors we've heard, which, honestly, I don't know how people even thought these were rumors. It felt, even watching The Force Awakens, I knew this was going to happen in the next movie, in Episode 8, and they are going to be doing this. We are actually going to see Luke Skywalker training Rey to be a Jedi on Ahch-To, because Ahch-To, as you all know, is a very significant planet, a very significant location for the Jedi Order, and of course it's a site of ancient temples. And apparently Luke has his own Jedi temple. I don't know if it's actually Luke's temple that he made himself, or if, more likely, he just took a temple and he's now using it for his own purposes. I'm gonna guess that's what's happening, but I'm interested to see that stuff regardless. Originally, Kylo Ren was gonna have a TIE Advanced, or not TIE Advanced, he was gonna have an Advanced TIE Fighter, which I guess you could call a TIE Advanced, in The Force Awakens. But they scrapped it last minute. You can find concept art very easily on Google Images if you want to check that out. I don't know if that's what he's going to look like in this new movie, The Last Jedi. It's probably been changed a little bit. It's going to be a little different. But I wouldn't be surprised if it was kind of close. And it looks pretty sweet, to be honest. And we all know that Kylo Ren is a bit of a Darth Vader daddy complex. He loves him. He would kiss him if he could. He wants to follow his footsteps, so not only is he just coming to the dark side as much as he possibly can, but he also, you know, he has TIE Advanced, just like Darth Vader did. He has a little meditation room, just like Darth Vader did. The only thing he needs now is to become more cybernetic being than man, which we may also see in The Last Jedi. I've got a speculation video on that, if you want to check that out. A lot of concept art, original concept art for Kylo Ren actually had Kylo Ren being more cybernetic being than man, a lot of cyborg-esque parts to him, arms, legs, all kinds of limbs, face. That was scrapped for The Force Awakens. Instead, I believe that they're gonna have more of a transformation for him from, you know, Episode 7 to 8 to 9. We'll see. But, there's actually more that's been confirmed by Disney since Episode 8 was officially announced, since the title was officially announced, namely that between Kylo Ren and Rey, and also some of Kylo Ren's knowings with Darth Vader. I guess we've known for a while now that Kylo Ren actually knew that Darth Vader wasn't completely with the Emperor's side, and he did fall back to the light, fall back to his ways of the Jedi before his death. Obviously, with Luke Skywalker turning him back toward the light. But I can't remember exactly how much Kylo Ren knew of those different happenings at the very end of the Empire. I'd be interested to know that. Massive, is Starkiller going to be in the Star Wars The Last Jedi? Because I almost thought you meant Starkiller Base. You're talking about Force Unleashed Starkiller. I don't think we're going to see the Force Unleashed Starkiller. I think that he is still canon as far as Disney's concerned in their universe. I could be wrong on that. They've announced most of what's canon and what isn't canon. So there's probably information out there somewhere. Dash Rendar, surprisingly, is actually canon in the new Star Wars universe. I thought he would have been scrapped with the rest of the expanded universe, but he's still part of the universe, which is wonderful. I'm relieved to hear that because he's one of my favorite characters. Kind of like Han Solo. He's actually featured in Shadows of the Empire. If you haven't played that game, it's pretty great, actually. If we get a game in 2017 terms that is Shadows of the Empire-esque in terms of size, scale, and scope, I will be happy. I will be very happy because just on its own right, outside of being a Star Wars game, it was seriously impressive stuff. So I'd like to see something else like that, but I highly doubt when to see Starkiller. It's possible they may, because, I mean, look at how they brought a Clone Wars character into Rogue One, you know? Forrest Whitaker did a good job bringing him to life on screen. He's an expanded universe character, the first expanded universe character to be featured on a Star Wars movie. And that's pretty impressive, so that definitely gives hope and weight to any character in the expanded universe being brought into the movieverse. Shit, I mean, the voice actress for Ahsoka. I'm probably butchering that name because it's been a little while since I've seen the Clone Wars, but the voice actress for Ahsoka actually said that she would love to play her in a live-action film, and I could actually see that. If you know what she looks like, she looks kind of close. You know? If you put some of that prosthetic makeup on her and, you know, have some of those practical effects in action with a little bit of on-screen magic and a little bit of Grand Moff Tarkining, what they did for him in Rogue One, I could totally see her playing Ahsoka in a live-action film, and I think that would be wonderful. I think that would be really cool to see. She's a fan favorite, which is a far cry from when the Clone Wars movie released. There was a time when the only Clone Wars cartoon we had was animated, and it was on Cartoon Network. And when I say animated, I mean like cel-shaded 2D animation, not 3D animation. And nobody liked her. Fanfic people and all those weird, you know, fanfic writers, they loved her. But the average audience, they didn't like her when she was first in that Clone Wars movie. The movie itself wasn't well received, but once the animated series came out, people liked it. And it's a good series. It's a really good series. I liked it. I like it myself. I don't even remember what the cartoon was like. Everybody pretty much enjoyed the cartoon to some extent back in those days. So, yeah, it's good. It's good. It's fun. It's a kid's cartoon, but it's still enjoyable. Will you shoot at me? Don't you shoot at me, Ishy Tip? Who do you think you are? Some kind of a bounty hunter? Come on! Ishy Tip aren't bounty hunters. Yes! Nice hit! Through the leaves, can barely even see him. DeMonte asks, do I have to have the game to play this? Unfortunately, you gotta have Battlefront to play it. But if you do have Battlefront, no matter what platform you're on, you can play Rogue One, Scarif, because it is free weekend for the DLC. You can play the battle of the movie like we're doing right now. We're actually going in for an invasion. So far, we have not been doing too well because we gotta arm one of these cargo ships for detonation, at least one of them, to provide an adequate distraction for the Imperial forces. And we have 1:40 to do that. I apologize if I sound a little congested. I am a little congested. Got my nose being a little stopped up. Did I say stopped up? What is that? The Stouffer's version of your nose being stuffed up? Oh, crap. Crap. Oh, God! Woo! Scared the shit out of me. Yes! Thank you, R4. You avenged my death. That's a good droid. Is that droid racist? That sounds patronizing, doesn't it? Good droid. It's kind of like good boy.
Don't let the Imperials near those explosives. We need
to find another droid appropriate, 2017 appropriate term to use for him. Well, we provided a distraction. It's one hell of a distraction. That is an enormous explosion. They're going to see that from the control tower. Curtis probably pissing his pants right now. Now that it's been a few months since Rogue One released, I got a question for you guys watching the chat room right now. Who's your favorite character in Rogue One? It could be anybody. It doesn't have to be one of the main characters. Shit, I mean, you could say C-3PO and I would accept that, even though he just had a small cameo. My favorite, even after months of cooling off, is Director Orson Krennic. I like him. I think he's really interesting, and I got some stuff to talk about as far as he's concerned as well. But there is a part of the Star Wars universe that we haven't really seen a lot of, and that's politics. It's ironic. But yeah, that's politics. And I know, prequel trilogy, politics, everyone hated that. But, I mean, everybody loved that boardroom scene in A New Hope. Everybody loved Grand Moff Tarkin and Darth Vader, you know, force choking some Imperials and stuff like that. That is what I want to see more of. I want to see some more infighting, because the infighting of the Empire was legendary. None of these people liked each other. They were all just waiting to stab each other in the back for promotion, for power.
Over here! R2-D2, get over here at once! This is no time for your foolishness. Follow you? Why should I do that, you bucket of bolts? How dare you call me that? I should have you deactivated. Fine. Go that way, you nearsighted scrapper. You'll soon wish he'd listen to me, that malfunctioning little rust bucket. R2, where did you go? R2-D2, I know your oral sensors are detecting me. I really don't know why I bothered with that little troublemaker.
And I'm back! Finally. Hold on, guys. Internet's been having some issues. Or something. Give me a sec.
R2-D2, just you come back here at once.
Okay, well. How long I'm back, I don't know. We'll see. Well, sorry about that outage. I don't even know how long I've been back on, but I've been trying some different things to get it back.
R2.
Not much I can do as far as I can tell. I'm not sure if the issue has to do with the voltage of the modem. It's possible it's the voltage of the modem, or it has to do with the internet around here. I think it's the internet. They haven't been able to find a solution, so they think it might have to do with the voltage that's going into the modem. Shit. Well, we're back now. I guess that's all that matters. Let's get back into a match. Let's do some infiltration. I've been having fun with that. I've thought about doing some Walker Assault, because I know you guys love your Walker Assault. You know what? Maybe we'll do some Walker Assault. I'll leave it up to you guys. Well, after this match, I guess, because we're already looking for one. But that's neither here nor there. It's Star Wars, right? It's all Star Wars. I actually got something I want to show you, so let me save this image. This isn't a spoiler image, it's an image of The Last Jedi, so there's that. That's exciting, but it's not going to be a spoiler, so don't worry. Let me see if I can pull it up. That's not the one. I don't even know what that is. I guess I'll replace this image. Let's see. This is an image of the stormtroopers from The Last Jedi. They've actually changed a little bit. So, welcome back. I'm not exactly sure what happened. The power to the modem went out or something. Anyway, I'm back. Internet's back online. I don't know what I was talking about before the internet went out, but we're back in a game. Let's move on. This is an image from The Last Jedi, or at least the set of Last Jedi. It's not a spoiler, so don't worry about that, but it is pretty cool. And it's the difference between the Stormtroopers of The Force Awakens and the Stormtroopers of The Last Jedi. And here it is. Oh, wait, that's really big. Let's see if I can. There we go. That's better. The right side is the last Jedi, First Order Stormtrooper. The left side is of the Force Awakens Stormtrooper. And if you're having trouble spotting the differences, look at the corner of the mouth, right next to that little light thing that you see there. And now look at the corner of the mouth over here. It's much wider. It's much bigger. It's not as pinched. And you can also see that the black line itself is a little bigger all around. And the nose, the bridge of the nose is more rounded than it is on The Last Jedi. The Last Jedi is more shark-like. It's a lot sharper as well. And it's more of a pan face. The chin juts out less on the First Order Stormtrooper Last Jedi than it does on the Force Awakens First Order Stormtrooper, which I'm a big fan of. It's overall a lot sharper. It's a lot less soft and a lot less defined in some ways, but more defined in others. In my opinion, it's more refined all around. I like it. I like it a lot. And I'm excited to see even more of the variations in action. I'm guessing if the basic First Order Stormtrooper variation was changed around a little bit, then maybe even the Flametroopers will be changed. Maybe we'll see some new Stormtrooper varieties in general. You know, we saw a baton anti-lightsaber Stormtrooper. Maybe we'll be seeing some versions of Shore Troopers, for example, or The Last Jedi's version of a Death Trooper. I'd like that. Whether we'll see that or not remains to be seen. Maybe we'll get some more leaks. I'm really excited to see what they're doing with Captain Phasma. There were some crazy rumors back at the launch of The Force Awakens that was talking about maybe Phasma in Episode 8 being a bounty hunter. You know, maybe she's disavowed by the First Order for her colossal failure in the field of battle, or rather in Starkiller Base, which later turned into the field of battle. But that's probably not going to be true. Hopefully, we just get to see some more of that awesome armor and some more character development, because she seemed like she could be an interesting character aside from being a hard-ass sergeant. Looks like we're having some internet issues even still, but it's still online. We're just dropping some frames, so it's not like we've been disconnected. That's a shame. That's a shame. I waited a couple hours this, because yesterday we had no problems, the day before that, no problems. I waited a couple hours today to see if I should stream or not, but I really wanted to, so against my better judgment, I decided I'd just go ahead with it, and this is the result. If I don't stream, it's either because I want a day off for my throat, or because I have to take a day off because the internet isn't working. And that's what's happening today. Oh my god! Well, I guess that's one way to take down a U-Wing. Head-on collision. What the heck is that? Oh, Y-Wings. Two Y-Wings were right on top of each other, grouped together, and I couldn't exactly tell what that shape was. Oh, come on. I didn't even scrape that piece of space wreckage. I'm going to try one thing real quick for the lag, and just to see if I can do something on my end. Lessen the load, so to speak. 5 seconds of darkness, and we'll be back online. We should be back online right now, so as you guys probably know, if you're not new to the channel, I have the highest bit rates around when it comes to live streaming. If you're looking for a high quality live stream in terms of video and audio, no live stream on YouTube uses a higher bit rate than me, because I use the maximum that YouTube allows. And they have a set limit. If you go beyond that limit, they're not too happy about it because it costs a lot for them in terms of servers. But I stretch that limit as much as I possibly can, giving you the highest quality video that I can. But I lowered it just a little bit to see if that would help out my internet, because my internet service provider is having a lot of stress today. They're having a lot of issues. So if I can alleviate some of that stress, maybe we won't have as much lag. And it looks like it's working. Yes! Finally! I have found a way to bust them! You think you can keep me without an internet? You think you can keep me off of live stream? And Cox. Oh, I love saying their name. That's what they are. They're a bag of Cox! And I didn't fix it because we just dropped some more frames. Oh, God. Am I still on? Am I here. Okay, okay. Ignore that weird question in the chat room. I'm back. Well, that's what I get for gloating, isn't it? I thought I fixed it. I thought I bested them. I didn't best shit. I fooled myself. I tricked myself. Speaking of being fooled and tricked, we gotta watch these rats of the rebellion. In fact, I'm gonna call in some TIE Striker support. Unfortunately, these rats, these cockroaches, these mongrels, these mutts, they're gonna try to put some detonator packs in these dropships. We can't allow that to happen, because if that happens, if they put some packs in those dropships and detonate them, they're gonna provide an ample distraction for their rebellion forces to then move in and take control of the beaches of Scarif. Hell, you'll see that explosion all the way from the control tower, and that, my friends, that is my TIE Striker support. Hope he's doing a good job up there. Bet they pay those TIE Striker pilots a heck of a lot of money. Probably even more money than TIE fighter pilots. For one thing, it's a specialized role, so it's not that common. I bet training is kind of uncommon, you know? Hiring that out can't be cheap. And then on top of that, you're flying low altitude. I mean, shit, you can shoot that thing if you want to with blasters on the ground. It's not that difficult. But imagine, it's a pretty dangerous job. Probably one that not a lot of pilots want to actually do. Nice hit. I think that guy actually utilized A180C, which is what I'm using, in cyber mode against me, but he just missed. Luckily, I didn't! There's a bit of a Saving Private Ryan scene there. Sniper v. Sniper. Massive, what is your favorite clone trooper, not stormtrooper? Because they aim and they... Not... Wait. Oh, because they cannot aim and they suck. Really? It's not the stormtroopers that suck. I mean, sometimes they do, but stormtroopers, if they're told to miss, they will miss. They didn't want to kill Luke. They didn't want to kill Leia. At least not at first. I mean, Darth Vader himself probably gave executive orders telling them to bring them in alive, which would explain their horrendous aim in the hallways of the Death Star in New Hope. I'm not sure about their orders in The Empire Strikes Back or Return of the Jedi. That you could say maybe the Force. But to answer your question, my favorite variation is clone trooper. That's a difficult question because I don't know their names. But in Attack of the Clones, my favorite variation was the red variation. I think it may have been a shock trooper, released a predecessor to the shock troopers, and I thought he was really cool. I actually had a little figure of him sitting at my desk. As far as episode 3 goes, my favorite variation of the Stormtrooper, Clone Trooper, would be Commander Cody, which is probably some command variation, some leader variation. I'm just gonna call it Commander variation. I'm assuming since he is Commander Cody, he is Commander, and that's probably what his variation is. So, Commander variation, specifically Obi-Wan Kenobi's Legion of Clone Troopers, because they got that awesome orange coloration, which is my favorite color. It's a very lively color, the color of orange. It's also the color of oranges, and I love oranges. Orange juice, sliced oranges, mandarin oranges, you name it. I'll eat it, as long as it's got oranges in it. I do not like chocolate-covered orange peels, though. I don't know why. When I was a kid, my mother and I went to this place called St. Augustine, which is a really cool place. If you've been there, you know what I'm talking about. It's got an enormous naval fort. Old naval fort. It's an old town. You got cobblestone streets. You got buildings that are hundreds upon hundreds of years old. It's really a beautiful place. They've got gallows. It's... You go to St. Augustine, it's like you took a step back in time. It's pretty wonderful stuff. They've got a lot of old world artisan bakeries and candy shops. This one place had orange peels, chocolate-covered orange peels, and I was like, you know what? That looks cool, and I love oranges. I'm gonna give that a shot. And I hated it! I don't know if I was just too young to appreciate it. I mean, you give a six-year-old a shot of whiskey, they just spit it right out. I was pissed! I gave a kid, I was walking in a park with my flask, you know, typical thing, around, I think it was 9 a.m. on a Sunday, I do that a lot. This kid was like, hey, mister, what you got in that flask? I was like, shit, man, you wanna sit, here you go, spit it right out. Slapped him upside the head, just like a man would in the 50s, back in the golden era of equality, 1950s, right there, perfect era, if you ask me. Man can go home, beat his wife, beat his children. Down a six-pack, get a pat on the back next day when he tells water cooler at work. What the hell was I talking about? Jesus Christ. What was I talking about? Guess I was talking about clone troopers. Shit, I don't know. I don't like chocolate-covered orange peels, though. I know that much. You get those things out of here! Don't get those things near my mouth! Maybe I was too young to appreciate it, but it was just bitter. And I could taste the orange peel and didn't taste good. No, no. Especially for that price. I felt gypped. I was a bigger fan of Hard Rock Candy, though, back in those days. I don't know why. Nowadays, Hard Rock Candy, yeah. I like it, but I don't love it. I was in love with that stuff. I was an active fan of Hard Rock Candy. Yes, but one of my favorite candies, well, I would say Hard Rock Candy. That's what it is. Hard Rock Candy, I love that shit. Nowadays, I'm kind of, I don't know. I like it, but I'm not going to go out looking for it. I also liked circus peanuts more back then. I don't know, it's just a little too sweet tasting today. Wish I could have gotten that shot. You know what? Let's use our smart rocket. Why not? Oh my god, what the hell was that? I'm getting scared now. I don't even know what that was that shot at me. Alright, let's get back down to the ground. Blaster cannon! Oh! That's like white bread. That's like Wonder Bread. I don't want to eat it, but I guess I'll use it. I don't know. We'll see if we can find a good place. Unfortunately for us, the Rebel scum are very active in this area. We'll be moving around a lot. It's like a pack of rats! Damn, this is a nice weapon. A180. Gotta give it up for that gun. It's great. Massive, which Stormtrooper class is your favorite? Alright, when I was growing up, I would say Dark Trooper. Yeah, without a doubt, I'd say Dark Trooper, but nowadays, I would say my favorite class of Stormtrooper is the... I think it's the Shock Trooper. Yeah. And I actually do prefer the First Order Stormtrooper designs to the original OG Stormtrooper designs. I know, that makes me an asshole. It makes me worse than Hitler, but what is going on here? Oh man, the air is sparking. I hate it when that happens. Makes it really difficult to open up propane tanks for fun. Shit. I don't think that was an automatic turret that shot me. I don't know why. Because it sounded like one. But the firing rate was kind of inconsistent. Wasn't like that of a robot, it was like that of a person. Looks clear. Wait. My radar's lighting up. Oh. There it is. Oh! It was an R4 unit, of course. Well, I don't wanna shit. Oh, R5 unit, my mistake. They're extremely powerful, though. I hate fighting them. They're mobile. They're seemingly... I think they got more armor than the Viper Probe droids. Anyway, let's go back to what I was talking about before, or what I wanted to talk about and didn't start talking about. There's a... If you know what Reddit is, then you know what I'm about to explain, but if you don't, this is for you. Reddit is kind of like an online forum. And if you don't know what a forum is, I feel bad for you because they're great places to be. There's thousands upon thousands of forums all across the internet. It's basically where you can talk to other people, like in the chat with the live stream right now. But permanent. So Reddit's kinda like that. There's subreddits, which are basically sub-forums around a certain theme or topic. And there's one called Maw Insulation. M-A-W, Insulation. My girlfriend turned me onto this. And it's a wonderful subreddit because it's all about fascinating things that you would read in a fact book. I don't know if you guys ever read books when you were a kid. I don't know, maybe your school forced it to. Maybe, you know, you just play hooky all day long until you became a greaser. Kept a little toothpick in your lips, started riding a motorcycle, started playing violent video games, started wearing all black, maybe wearing some trench coats, but I like to hang out in bookstores and read books, because I found it interesting, and I found the books interesting, and I would love it if I could find a Star Wars book full of Star Wars facts and things that I didn't know. Well, Monstellation is all about that. You can post a question, for instance, how much did a Stormtrooper cost? Or how much did a clone trooper cost? That's a fascinating question. I never even thought about that. I saw it today on the subreddit. Because we know how much soldiers cost. It's like, what is it, 50,000? Shit. I think it might be less than that. Like, if you're discounting the soldier's life, and if it's just, you know, what he's outfitted with, I think it's like 20,000, something like that, but... Yeah. Stuff like that. All kinds of fascinating questions. Anyway, look into it. Visit it. It's really good. But, that's where I found some of the stuff I wanted to talk about today. For instance, how heavy is a lightsaber? What was the weight of it? I never even thought about that. Thinking about it now, how heavy would it be? Would you feel all the force near the hilt? Is the blade itself heavy? It's made out of light, I guess. That's just what it's called. It's probably not made out of light. But, I feel like it would be an extremely awkward weapon to use if all the weight was at the hilt. Imagine that, just all the weight of that blade at the handle. And that's it. You know, you don't even feel the blade itself. No matter how long or short the lightsaber blade is during lightsaber fights, that would be excruciatingly frustrating to just be, like, fighting and clashing with this weighted hilt. But apparently, Jyn Erso. It wasn't just the hilt. It wasn't just what you held onto with your handle. Because in Star Wars Rebels, which is the new Star Wars television show, they were actually talking about the weighted lightsaber, which is great. It feels like Star Wars Rebels is a chance for all of these Star Wars nuts and Star Wars nerds like ourselves to write these episodes and put in all these interesting little facts that people wonder about and never really asked or wasn't officially answered. And they actually answered that in a recent episode. They were talking about how it was actually heavier than they initially thought it would be. The data tape has been dropped. A character picked it up and they're like, wow, this is heavier than I thought it would be. And they're like, yeah, it is. Apparently, you can actually feel the force of the blade. And I'm not talking about the force itself. I'm talking about... let me see if I can actually find what they called it. Okay, you're not fighting with a simple blade, like you would be in a sword, as much as you're directing a current of power. And that is pretty much all I need to know. That really explains it for me. And it breaks it down in a way that I'd never considered before. It's something that I subconsciously thought about and I guess assumed, but you're directing a current of power. And that's really what a lightsaber is. Functionality speaking too makes sense. I don't know. I like that. Actually it makes lightsabers a little cooler than me. The current of power. I guess that takes away the mysticism of lightsabers just a little bit, but we've also kind of always known how lightsabers works. You know, you got the kyber crystal and you got the mystical aspect to it, you know. The Jedi make their own lightsabers, just like Luke Skywalker created his own, he built his own lightsaber. I believe Anakin built his own lightsabers as well. I think it's a thing with... Ignore what I was talking about before. That might have sounded weird. Welcome back. This is probably going to be the last match, because it cannot be relied upon. The internet cannot be relied upon today, unfortunately. Hopefully tomorrow, maybe. Man, I'm glad I don't have old people's skin. I know everyone will someday, but that's just a terrifying thought. Back in Florida, when I lived in Florida, there was a place called Publix, and it was a wonderful, wonderful grocery store. But knowing Florida, as I do, there are a lot of retired people there, a lot of elderly people, and whenever you went to your car, whatever age you are, even if you're virile 20-year-old man with Chris Hemsworth muscles, you can ask the people, you know, bagging your groceries to take it to your car for you, and they will load it up. But if an elderly person did that, like 9 years old, and if they needed help in your car, like, I would see them in the parking lot lifting these elderly people into their cars, and it would just give me a fucking panic attack, because their skin, if you just pinched it, it would start bleeding, and oh my god. Ah, I don't know how they did that. I could not lift an elderly person into a car like that. It would just freak me the hell out. Oh god, their skin's still on my hands. Oh god. Oh, Jesus Christ. Well, we're back into a match. And this is not Walker Assault. This ain't Walker Assault! Anyway, we were talking about lightsabers before the internet went out, but now we're going to be talking about how the Death Star 1 changed the dynamics of power in the Empire. This is something that I read on Monstellation earlier today, and it was fascinating. If you'll remember the destruction of the Death Star Yavin 4, when it was destroyed by rebels, that was a huge, huge blow to the Empire. I mean, picture this. This is an enormous installation of countless resources spent to create it, with countless lives and soldiers and TIE fighters on board. You gotta remember, the Death Star is not just a Death Star. The Death Star had countless TIE fighters, countless ships, countless stormtroopers, officers, soldiers, gunnery sergeants, anything and everything you can imagine. Not to mention food, credits, probably, most likely. I'm sure they had some valuable resources that weren't just, like, digital or whatever, you know? That's a lot of money. That is a hell of a lot of money, not to mention that they lost the Moth Tarkin. And he was the second in command around the time of A New Hope. Darth Vader and Grand Moff Tarkin were actually the same rank. They couldn't order each other around. I mean, they respected each other, or at least Vader respected the Moff Tarkin. So he would listen to him, if it was appropriate, but losing the second-in-command and the Death Star at the same time, that is a huge blow. So I naturally was very intrigued by this thread to see what other people said about what they thought on how big of a blow it was. And Vader really had to step in to fill Tarkin's role in the Empire, because with Tarkin gone, that is an enormous hole. You could see the enigma that was Grand Moff Tarkin in Rogue One, his charisma, his pull, his power, his presence. When that was lost, Vader just picked it up. He picked it up, he had to fill that role, fill in the pieces. He wasn't very respected in A New Hope, but he started to become respected, or at least feared, in Empire. And I would say that Vader was feared more than he was respected. I don't think that Vader was widely respected in the Empire. A lot of officers especially didn't take him seriously, even after A New Hope. So I honestly think that Tarkin was irreplaceable and Vader was not a suitable replacement for Tarkin and what Tarkin meant to the Empire. Regardless, when the Death Star was destroyed, the Emperor and Darth Vader figured out quickly that it was a Jedi that was piloting that X-Wing when it was destroyed. In fact, Vader, because he was in the trench, in his TIE Advanced, trying to take down the X-Wing, trying to take down those Y-Wings, and, you know, all the different leaders, and even the Millennium Falcon, but he was there. I'm sure that's when and where he felt the presence. I'm not sure how exactly they found out that it was Jedi and the X-Wing, pilot of the X-Wing, that made the trench run, but I'm pretty sure it was Vader that felt it in the Force. But that's when it became a Sith matter. And this is what's so fascinating about it, is because it was not an Imperial matter at that point. It was not a military matter or a political matter. It was then a matter of the Sith, because that was the Jedi coming back and attacking them personally, after Palpatine thought he had wiped them out. All of them. And hey, look at this, we're piloting a U-Wing. Fantastic. This is our chance to spearhead the invasion. As difficult as it will be. Oh shit, that is a homing missile and I am hit. I am hit. That is not good. I'm gonna... Oh my god, that took me out fast. I was being kind of stingy with my shielding and anti-lock capabilities, so I didn't use them. I just used my shield. I mean, speed boost. I should have used my anti-lock capabilities initially once they started locking onto me with their torpedoes, but I was a little late to that party. And I'm sure that the balancing has been changed since I last played, but whatever. We all know those are just excuses. Massive making up excuses as usual to his lack of
UN
prowess.
We need to deal with those Imperial fighters.
But yeah, even if Tarkin had survived the Death Star at Yavin 4, I think he wouldn't have been punished or anything for it being his fault. There. Maybe a little bit, but he's still too important. Even still, he would no longer have been the second in command. I feel like Vader would have stepped up and taken his place if he had escaped the destruction of the Death Star, because it still would have become a Sith matter. And this is kind of like Germany in the 1930s and 1940s with the Nazis taking over, things changing, and the Nazis creating certain events happening, so then the Nazis would have even more power and governance over the entire state. And that is kind of what inadvertently happened with Death Star. It gave the Sith far more power than the Empire itself, because they needed to enact not only suitable revenge on the Jedi, but also to take the appropriate actions to stop the balance returning to the Force. Yeah, well, I'm playing on the PS4 version, for those of you guys that are wondering. It's amazing how gorgeous this game is on consoles or on PC. Really, really excited to see the next Battlefront, which is coming this year. It's so soon. Surely, inevitably, we will see something for the Force celebration. And maybe even before that, but definitely for the celebration, I'm really excited. I am a big fan of the sequel trilogy. I know a lot of people aren't. A lot of people don't like the sequel trilogy just because it's popular and it's new, and they want the same feeling of superiority like they had with the prequel trilogy, because when they were shitting on the prequel trilogy when that became popular, it felt so smart. So many people felt so intelligent, being like, I don't like this movie even though it is Star Wars. I don't like it because of all these different reasons of my childhood being ruined. Because I am smart, and I know that I am a film critic deep down, and that is my spirit animal. Actually, I identify as a film critic. So if you not refer to me as my gender of being a male, and instead of being a film critic, I would appreciate that very much. You cannot like the prequel trilogy. I don't care. There's a lot of things I don't like with the prequel trilogy as well, but it is, you have to admit, something that's extremely popular to hate upon, and something that makes a lot of people feel very smart and very secure about themselves, because they don't like something that was at one point very popular. And same thing's happening right now with the sequel trilogy. You know, a lot of people are being like, actually, the Fourth Awakens was just a new hope, so it's bad. Yeah, it's not good. And Ray the Mary Sue. Just like to say with Mad Max Fury Road, even though Mad Max Fury Road is a masterpiece. But I enjoy those movies, along with tens of millions of people. The vast and great majority of people like The Force Awakens and enjoy it and have fun with it because it's a fun movie. And then you have the vocal minority on the internet that are too smart for it, blah blah blah. And then you have the other minority, which is actually people that just earnestly don't like it very much. And those are the people that I'm fine with. Regardless, I like the movies. And I can't say movies because it's just one movie. I don't know what The Last Jedi will be like. I don't know if it's going to be better than The Force Awakens or worse. Judging by the original trilogy, it may be the best. Obviously, a lot of trilogies have been made with films in general, and a lot of the time, the second movie is the best movie. Obviously, that will not be the case with Avengers, because Age of Ultron was not too good, just objectively speaking, unfortunately. Especially with how they dealt with Ultron. They've done this a few times now. They've copped out. They had a chance with the Mandarin to make a really cool, engaging villain, and they made him funny man. And they had a chance with Ultron to make a really cool and engaging villain, and they made him funny man. They like funny men. These Marvel movies, they're all laughs. It's all funny. If people say DC movies are all serious, Marvel movies are all chuckle fests. And we got another U-Wing! Okay, let's make some use out of this thing. So far, so good. Oh crap, here they come. Alright, they're getting some locks. We have scrambled their locks so far. Going for another speed boost! Beautiful, and what a gorgeous craft this U-Wing is. I love it! I love it! I did not like the U-Wing at first, but it grew on me, especially when I saw it in action in Battlefront. I was like, you know what, this thing's actually pretty badass. I love a huge wingspan with vehicles. I just love it. I like me some big vehicles. I'm not talking Hummer, but if it's a long car or a wide car, but kind of like thin on the top. If it's narrow height-wise, but long or wide, I like that, and that's what the U-Wing is. It's pretty long, it's really wide, but it's short. I love that, with cars and spaceships. Plenty of Falcons is another example. It's long, and it's wide, and it's short. In fact, I can't really think of a tall space Enterprise. Enterprise is tall. It's got that neck thing. But I like the Enterprise. It's just different. Can't really think of a ship that's tall, really. I guess some command ships or capital ships, but that doesn't really count because, you know, those are basically mobile battleships or buildings. Damn, we got a lot of U-Wings inbound. We have 4 U-Wings inbound. I'm going to see if I can give them absolute backup. TIE fighter spotted. Oof, flew right past me. I know where he's going. Nice. Nothing's going to... Whoa! I stand corrected. That U-Wing has been taken out. We have 1 U-Wing, 2 U-Wings remaining. All right, now we have 1 U-Wing remaining. He actually made it through without any backup from yours truly. So,
U-Wings, find a secure
good job.
Land. We'll mobilize from there.
I always feel bad for that last little TIE fighter. I mean, X-Wing. That would be me. I would be the one that wouldn't make it through. But yeah, I got enough space. And they're like, pull up! Pull up, you goddamn idiot! You're gonna crash! Yeah, don't worry about it. I got enough space. I'll make it through. Don't worry about it. Famous last words. Don't worry about it. I got enough space. It's okay. This looks like a Luger. Oh my god, it's a Luger. Oh my god! How did I not notice that before? Look at this thing.
Look at this. It's a Luger.
It's a goddamn Luger. I love the Luger. P-28. I think it's officially. Maybe it's P-20. I can't remember. But, such a beautiful weapon. Most of the weapons of the original trilogy of Star Wars are actually based off of real-world guns. Guns from World War I, World War II, whatever they could pick up for a cheap price. And, you know, whatever was scrapped and non-functional. They would just take it apart, make it into something new, make it into something really cool, really spacey. And most people don't even realize it. The average film goer didn't even know. They didn't even question it, which is fantastic. I am actually amazed by that. It wasn't until I was older that I started questioning, you know what? That looks like a gun. That looks like a real gun. That's actually something that set Star Wars apart. Back when the original trilogy first released in theaters, it wasn't a bunch of shiny chrome Padme guns. You know, it was a bunch of buck spaceman guns. These guns look like they actually kill somebody. They looked dangerous. They weren't retro. They didn't have fins. They weren't shiny red. They weren't classic space blasters. And that's something that audiences just weren't used to seeing. It was something that was very new, very novel. Jaden says, why can't they have it free like PS3? PS3 doesn't have Battlefront, so you must be talking about something that I didn't see in the chat room. But if you're talking about the free weekend, the free weekend is free on all consoles. No matter what console or platform you have Battlefront on, you can play the movie Rogue One right now for free. Well, not the movie. You can play the battles of Scarif from the movie. Really, I would say that was the only battle in Rogue One, was the Battle of Scarif. I wouldn't say there were any battles on the sand planet. What was that called?
Do not let them hear your explosive charge.
Shit. Can I remember? I don't know why I can't remember. I'm drawing a blank. I'm terrible with names. Names of people, names of planets. Whatever. Anyway, Jedha! There we go. And the chat room didn't even tell me! I got it all on my own. I thought of it all by myself like a big boy. Massive, do you remember a while back I told you the Death Star would blow up Scarif and you were iffy about it? How about that? Well, cast me outside and I'll teach you how you're wrong. How about that? You know what? I'm gonna cast you right now. I'm gonna cast you in like a bad check and you're gonna be bounced off the floor. As soon as I chop your head off with facts, the sword of truth! You see, that's not even blow up Scarif now, did it? It blew up the Imperial installation of Scarif, wiped it off of the face of the planet. But that was it, you know, the planet was fine. It was a test firing, really. Or they just use like one reactor, something like that. Yeah, it was like Jedha. It was a little tiny test fire, a little pea shooter. That's all it was, nothing more. But, yeah, I didn't think that Scarif would be shot. I didn't think that Scarif would be touched, so you're right. You're right about that. Oh my god, look at you! Look at you, look at you, shit! I knew he was gonna do that. Ugh. Internally thinking to myself, please, do not. Stay in the corner. Stay in the goddamn corner. Stay in cover! He didn't do it. He knew that if he killed himself, he would kill me as well. He'd take me with him. And that was worth it in his book. I don't blame him. That was smart. Because he was going to die anyway. You know? Why not? Okay, then. We got ourselves a data tape. And I am now on the map of every single Imperial in this era. George Trooper, Storm Trooper, Death Trooper, whatever. They're all looking for me. Close. Too close. Give me a thermal imploder, please. That's pretty good. I'll take that. Oh yeah. Thank God. Thank God. Turret has been planted, and it's got its first draw of blood. Oh, one shot at me. Oh God. Oh God. Oh my God, he was behind me. He's got a Bose rifle. I didn't even realize that people still use the Bose rifle anymore. I don't know if it was that popular. It was extremely popular back at the launch of Rogue One DLC because it's a one-hit kill melee weapon. And looks like he's still rocking it. That's cool. I appreciate that. Damn it! Got another useless turret. Whoa! I was reading the chat room instead of looking in front of me. Massive, we need to do another Battlefield 1 server war. Next Battlefield 1 launch is probably going to be for the DLC that's related. Ghost Recon Wildlands open beta is coming out next week. Pretty excited about that. And I've also got a really cool opportunity from Ubisoft to play Ghost Recon Wildlands before it releases. Not the beta, the full game. They're giving the full game to me, I think, I can't remember. Anyway, I got it a few days before release, and I can make videos for it. I'm asking them if I can pretty please from Chicken Top live stream it. They're considering it, so I got my fingers crossed about that. We also have Horizon Zero Dawn launching February 28th. Brain fart. Apologize. That's more like brain diarrhea. January. My God, that's last month. February is on its way out. No way in hell we're still in January. Unless I'm in the Twilight Zone. If I was in the Twilight Zone, I'd... Well, people would be speaking Japanese, or I'd wake up and somehow now be able to speak Chinese or something like that. That's a little more Twilight Zone-y. You always know if you're in the Twilight Zone by what language you can speak when you wake up, or what language other people can speak. It's actually a terrifying thing. There's one episode of the Twilight Zone, this guy woke up and his wife was like, "Hi, honey, how are you? Would you like to have some dinosaur this morning? I got dinosaur already made. It's on the table." Well, guess what? Somehow, when he woke up, the word breakfast was replaced with the word dinosaur. And if that sounds weird, this is from the 80s Twilight Zone. This isn't from the 60s, so it gets a little weird. And day by day, more and more words start being replaced, and he doesn't know what the hell they are. He can't ask somebody, because how the hell are you going to ask somebody, what does dinosaur mean? They're like, what the fuck? It's like asking, in our world, what does breakfast mean? What do you mean, what does breakfast mean? What's what we eat? And then, it's like, desk is replaced with moon pie, and hand is replaced with garble gorbin. That's horrifying. And apparently this is actually possible to be a medical condition for something that actually happened in real life to somebody outside of something like the Twilight Zone. And if that happened to me, I wouldn't be able to cope. I am horrible with names. I suck with names. So I would not be able to remember any of this shit. I couldn't adapt. I would be dead in the water. Shit. Speaking of dead in the water, I'm stuck. I can't jump. I can crouch. Oh, crap. That was close. There's too many shore troopers around. Hell, they're all shore troopers. Damn it! Kill for a kill. Not too bad. MassiveG, will you join the dark side of the Force? Yes, I would. Would I? I've got a legitimate question for you guys, and think about this, alright? You know what? This is a question for all you guys, not just the ones talking in the chat room. If you're watching full screen, default screen. If you're not signed in, sign in. I want to know, but before you answer, please actually think about this. It's not any fun if you're just like, broccoli! You ought to give me a real answer. Think about it as if your life depended on it, as if, like, if you said yes to one thing or the other, you would actually have to do it and become it to the fullest extent. No second guesses, no cold feet, none of that. Okay, chat room and everybody in it. Would you be part of the light side or the dark side of the Force? Think about this, all right? If you were magically just poof into the Star Wars universe, in the shoes of whoever you said you'd be part of, light side or dark side, if you say you'd be part of the dark side of the Force, you're basically admitting to be a psychopath, all right? Because if they say murder children, you do it without a second thought in your mind. You just go into the maternity ward and you stick your lightsaber in those babies. As horrible as that is, that's what you chose, all right? That's what we're talking about here. I couldn't do that. As cool as the dark side is, as cool as General Grievous is and all that stuff, I couldn't stick a lightsaber in babies. I could not burn babies alive. I couldn't gas people. I couldn't do that. I couldn't murder innocent people. It feels so wrong. Yeah, I'd like to wear the uniform. I'd like to wear the Stormtrooper armor. I'd love to wear Darth Vader's armor, but I couldn't do it. I'd be a Jedi. I guess I'd be a Jedi, yeah. Kinda sucks, but I guess that's just the sacrifice I'd have to make. Has to be something as uncool and lame as a Jedi. What color would my lightsaber be? Now that's the real question, that's the hard question. What color would my lightsaber be? I don't know. I'm seeing a lot of surprising answers here. You guys are scaring me. I'm seeing some dark sides, like some serious dark sides. You would murder babies? Go call your mother up and tell her you would murder babies. Go do that right now. Call up your girlfriend, call up your wife, call up your husband, whatever. Go tell them that you would just gladly murder babies so you could wear a badass uniform. I mean, granted, it is pretty badass. You basically wear a chrome helmet and nobody would care. You could wear a shiny black helmet, be all scary, you know, talk with a deep voice. Nobody would care. In fact, they would applaud you for it. They'd be like, you know, that's a good bad guy. That's a damn good bad guy or bad girl. You know? Bad girl doesn't sound right. It sounds like a porn parody. A bad woman? That doesn't sound right either. No! Oh! I guess bad guy just really isn't gender specific. All right, New question, what color would your lightsaber be? Obviously, if you say red, you have to... I mean, I'm sure there's been some expanded universe where somebody was like a Jedi and they had a... red weapon, red lightsaber. We ain't doing that. We're doing current, confirmed shit, alright? None of that expanded universe. For me, I mean, my favorite color is orange, but we've seen like one orange lightsaber, and I think it was some place in the Colosseum during Attack of the Clones, but I don't think my lightsaber would be orange. I think my lightsaber would be... shit. Not that. Can you imagine? You just, like, activate your lightsaber instead of... You have, like... A bunch of diarrhea just spits out of it. You're dueling a pro's like, what the fuck? What the fuck? Shit's coming out of your lightsaber! Kylo Ren would really be screwed. He's got 3 points. Diarrhea just gonna be... It's okay, it's not real diarrhea. Otherwise, you'd hear it like hitting a metal pan or something. Just stick my ass up in the microphone, just coat it.
Data tape dropped.
What a shitty conversation we just had. Gah! That was my fault. How did he kill him with one hit, though? That's what I'm curious about. Gold. Sad. A lightsaber color? I think that's a... I think you mean yellow. My color would be Sarcoline. Sarcoline? What the hell is Sarcoline? Please consult with your doctor before taking Sarcoline. Sarcoline could cause rectal dysfunction. Rectal anomalies like diarrhea. Erectile diarrhea dysfunction. Please consult with your doctor to see if you're susceptible to erectile diarrhea dysfunction before taking Sarcoline. Rainbow. I don't think that's a lightsaber color. That's a couple colors. I mean, I guess if you had Kylo Ren's lightsaber, you could have like a yellow one on the right side and a blue one on the left side and a green one in the middle. I don't know. That'd look kind of silly. It'd look like a 5-year-old's lightsaber. I don't know about that. Sounds like an ice pop, too. You got rainbow ice pops. You don't got rainbow lightsabers. Pink. I bet a pink lightsaber would look awesome. I've never seen one, though. We've seen white lightsabers now. I believe Ahsoka's lightsabers are whites. That's awesome. I still want to see a pink one. Oh my god, can you imagine if they made Rey's lightsaber pink? Holy shit. I mean, if it was real life, and she could find a pink kyber crystal or something, she'd probably be like, yeah, pink's cool. I like pink. I like pink. I love pink. But, you know, it's a gender thing. I mean, when I go out, like, to a restaurant and I put on my pink bib, people make fun of me. Excuse me, it's 2017. If I want to wear a pink bib, there's nothing weird about that. Which means now when I go out, I have like a lacy white one, and nobody bats an eye. They look at it. I mean, when I go in a restaurant and take this big lacy bib out, I get a lot of people staring. But no weird looks like with the pink one. So I guess they just like. Sometimes I tell them where I get it. I'm just staring. They're like, Amazon. Help them out, you know. Black lightsaber. I don't think that's a real thing. White lightsaber, purple light, a lot of purples. Purple is an awesome lightsaber color. I actually have a Mace Windu's lightsaber at my house. It's one of those older ones where you could, like, shit, I don't know. It's like the replicas, but not the really good replicas. It's the official replica. You want unofficial replicas if you want a really good lightsaber. Turquoise, double saber, crimson saber. A lot of unique colors of you guys. I'm boring. My lightsaber would either be blue or green. I don't know which. Qui-Gon had a green lightsaber and it was beast. Luke has a green lightsaber and it's gorgeous. The Chosen One's lightsaber though. Obi-Wan's lightsaber though. I don't know which one I would go with. Green or blue, though. Hardest decision I would ever make in my life, but it's one of those two colors. Oh, darksaber. Yeah, that's true. Darksaber did exist. That's the most honest answer I've heard all day. Road Glider said, honestly, if I had access to a real-life lightsaber, I wouldn't care what color it was. Preach it, baby! He knows what he's talking about. Massive, what job will you have in the Empire? Janitor. Probably. No, I wouldn't like it if I was an officer. That's what I'd like to be. Maybe eventually a moth. Yeah, if I'm honest, I'd probably be a Krennic. I would be able to advance myself to his level of pedigree. I'd be able to pursue my career to that level of esteem, but I'd kind of cap off at a certain point because I'm just not as much of a bitchin' badass as Tarkin. I could be mostly badass, Krennic level badass, but Tarkin? Come on, I'm not gonna lie to you guys, I'm gonna be realistic. Krennic level badass, but not Tarkin level badass. That is what my job in the Empire would be. I'd be an officer, but an officer that would be outwitted by another officer because I'm just not quite as ruthless. I mean, I'm ruthless, but I'm not child murdering ruthless. Shit, you think Tarkin would think twice if he had to murder a kid? Goddamn no, he wouldn't. Shit, he murdered two just to be safe. I'm not like that. There's a lot of people in the Empire that weren't like that. Just because they're part of the Empire doesn't mean they're evil. You know, a lot of people, it's just a job. They got mouths to feed. They got kids. They got a wife. Shit, man. Steady paychecks. Not easy to find in that galaxy. Especially with insurance. And job security. You want job security, you go with the Empire. Well, I mean, not after episode 5. But before then, yes. I would open up a blue milk stand. That's very pleasant, Alan. Although I think that's more suited for a 6, 7, 8-year-old. You'd kind of be taking away business from them. They open up stands on the side of space cul-de-sacs all the time. Charge like 5 cents for a glass. Actually, that was more in the space 50s. 5 cents a glass. Nowadays, it'd be about $1 a glass. And then you gotta figure out your supplier for the mail, you know, do you go to Space Walmart or Space Costco? This is tricky business. MassiveG, Rip came first, the Phantom Menace of the Old Republic. The Old Republic, of course. Or wait, the Phantom Menace, that's referring, yeah, the Old Republic, obviously. Old Republic is way older than that. I was trying to think of a trick question of the Phantom Menace. It's referring to, Palpatine, right? He's the Phantom Menace in the Phantom Menace, right? I'm pretty sure it is. It's so weird that I don't instantly know for sure. Not because I'm a Star Wars fan, but because it's the name of the movie. You'd think that you would just know. And I guess you could say that's a bad thing about the movie, that you don't know who the Phantom Menace is in your heart. A lot of people think it's Maul. I don't think it's Darth Maul. He's an apprentice! He's an apprentice, got his torso cut in half, get out of here, he's a cool character, but he's no Phantom Menace. Shit, he wasn't even a Phantom. Palpatine was more of a Phantom in that movie than he was. See, you can't be like, I would be a clone commander in Kashyyyk. You're not a clone? You gotta be realistic about it, you can't be like, well, it'd be cool. I would be General Grievous is who I would be, but I would kill Obi-Wan instead of being killed by him. That doesn't work! You're like those kids that I had growing up in my cul-de-sac where, they would be like, we'd be playing a game, probably laser tag or something like that, and they'd be like, I would shoot him, right? And win. And I'd be like, you didn't shoot me. Yes, I did. Your chest light's flashing on the tablet. No, it's not. No, it's not. Your chest light's flashing. I shot you. And you're like, come on, man. Jesus, I shot you. Let's just go inside and have some candy and soda. And let's be done with it. You just gotta admit that I shot you, that we can go inside, have some candy and soda, cool off, play some video games, and have some fun times with kids. It's not that hard. And then be like, actually, I've got, like, super armor protection. Nothing hits me. I got plot protection, bitch. And then that's when I'd slash him across the face, something. Tell the parents that I, you know, they trip, whatever. And if they told the parents that they didn't trip and I slashed them, then that's what I slapped my parents too. They knew not to bitch with me. They knew. Phantom Menace means a hidden danger. Yeah, but what if it's like a, you know, double entendre? I think it's a double entendre in Phantom Menace case.
And really, the hidden danger is Palpatine. That's the prequel trilogy for me is more of a Palpatine origin story than it is an Anakin origin story. But yeah. Massive, we do another Star Season live stream. Hopefully soon. I'll probably do one before the next update, but I'm really looking forward to the next update because it's supposed to add a lot of content. But that's really cool. That's how you found my channel, man. That's awesome. I'm really happy that you were looking for Star Season stuff. A lot of people on my channel learn about Star Season from me. So it's cool to have it both ways. It really is. And I really like that game. There's actually a new update to Star Citizen in terms of Spectrum. Spectrum is a wonderful way to organize organizations like ours, the MassiveG Star Citizen organization. We're going to begin using Spectrum a lot in our streams and Star Citizen videos and stuff like that for coordination, all that stuff. My girlfriend's already using it. She loves it. She is a very, very good leader. She is leading our Star Citizen organization whenever I'm not, which has been a lot lately because I've been so busy. But she's on top of things when it comes to Star Citizen news, man. She's really good at that. She knows everything. If I have a question about Star Citizen, I don't even Google it anymore. Just ask her. She's my Google. And I'm an 80-year-old man. I wish they had a movie strictly about the 501st Anakin all the way up to when he became Darth Vader. They could still do it. I think. I don't think Hayden Christensen is that old. Wow, how crazy would that be? Hayden Christensen having a role bigger than a cameo role in a Star Wars movie again. Uh-oh, that would be interesting. Hayden Christensen is not the worst part of the prequel trilogy by a long shot. Neither is kid Hayden Christensen, whoever the hell that is. What was his name? Jacob... I think it was Jacob Johnson. Let me see if I'm right. Okay, I'm way off. Way off. Alright, his name wasn't Jacob Johnson, it was Jacob Lloyd? I don't know where I got Jacob- Death Trooper! I will defend Director Krennic with my life. Where'd he go? There he is. I'm like a Stormtrooper minion. I just defend whatever's evil. I would defend whoever is evilest, even if that means Director Orson Krennic. Now if I could defend Grand Moff Tarkin, that would be even more desirable, but since he is not available, Krennic is my man. I doubt that Death Troopers would defend anybody but Krennic, though. Unless Krennic ordered it, or someone else ordered it at a higher rank, because Death Troopers were actually a god, conceptualized by Orson Krennic himself. That's why I don't see them in any of the other Star Wars movies. It was basically a Krennic experiment, it was a Krennic thing, it was Krennic. And as for the U-Wings, TIE Strikers, Short Troopers, they just didn't have a place in the other Star Wars movies. They didn't have a role for those environments that they fought in. Do you see any beaches in the Star Wars movies? No. No, that's why I didn't see Imperial Stormtroopers. Did you see TIE Strikers? Well, there weren't any shores! And, aside from those things, what the fuck? Was that left over from the last round? That's crazy. Anyway, I've explained all that stuff before, you know all that. Let me start up a party. I totally forgot. I'm sorry about that. See if I can make a party real quick. So, where's my group? Is it in here? Favorite groups? Nope. Oh, that's different. That's groups. Community is what I'm looking for. It's a new tab now. I'm a couple updates behind. I'm going to create a party if you guys want to join up. Our party on PlayStation 4 is called MassiveG. And I don't know if you can join up mid-game, but you probably can. I think that's possible as long as somebody leaves. There it is. That is the official community. UI is so slow. There it is. Party for community members. It's going to be called GG. Because that's the easiest name I can make. It's so fast. Lands me right on G. Logan says Star Wars Rebels is probably the worst Star Wars series. I haven't heard that. I've only really heard praise for Rebels. I mean, every once in a while I hear someone that doesn't like it, but for the most part, everybody likes Rebels, or at least enjoys it. Some people love it. Quite a few people love it. I haven't seen an episode myself. I can see where people don't like the art style, but it's not that far off from the Clone Wars. And honestly, it's pretty close to Ralph McQuarrie's original concept art for Star Wars. If you look at the Stormtroopers, if you look at Darth Vader, if you look at the vehicles, it's pretty close. So I can see where they got the inspiration for the art style. It's a little more stylized than even the concept art was, but, you know, that's neither here nor there. Rebels seems to deal with a lot of things in the Star Wars universe that wasn't dealt with before, and that is what really intrigues me about it, even more so than the Clone Wars did. For instance, we actually see... Oh, shit, I'm gonna die. Oh, shit. No! We actually see headlights on AT-ATs. If you didn't know, AT-ATs actually have headlights. Well, I don't know if they call them headlights. They have searchlights or spotlights or whatever, floodlights, so they can see in front of them at night. I never knew that, but I do now thanks to Rebels. They even recently on an episode dealt with lightsabers and what they feel like, the weight of them. Apparently, to a new user, they will feel heavier than they initially thought that it would. They'll be surprised by the weight, but the more that they use the lightsaber, the lighter it will feel. I guess that's either just part of someone naturally becoming accustomed to it or the Force. I would say it would be a little bit of both. See some assault rifles. Yeah, baby! Get some! Get some! Straight up shot me in the back. I see how it is now. You son of a bitch. I can definitely mourn the Clone Wars too. I know a lot of you guys in particular subscribed to the channel are a big fan of the Clone Wars. I'm a fan of the Clone Wars. I like the prequel trilogy. I enjoy it. And I think the Clone Wars is a perfect setting for war, obviously. It's all about war. And it's a pretty cool war. You got droids and you got clones. More so than that, though, it'd be perfect for a Battlefront. I would love to see a Battlefront with 2017 plus tech fighting like 100 clones and 100 CIS. That's what I want, actually. Initially, I wanted the next Battlefront coming in 2017 to be about the Clone Wars. And then the Battlefront after that would be about the sequel trilogy, because we'd be three movies in. You know, plenty of source material. But we're not getting that. We're getting a sequel trilogy Battlefront, which may have some other universes or eras inside of it. But, to be frank, and if you haven't seen my video on Battlefront 2017, please check it out. It's on my channel. You can find it really easily just by typing in Battlefront 2017 into YouTube, or by typing Battlefronts into the search bar on my channel. You'll find it pretty quickly. Regardless, I want this next Battlefront coming in 2017 to be just about the sequel trilogy and add in DLC for episode 9. And then I want the next Battlefront after that, around 2019 or 2020, to be all about the Clone Wars, you know? Because we're done with the sequel trilogy at that point, and we have so much progress between the years 2017 and 2020 that it would look incredible. Just by appearance, by graphics, by tech, it would be amazing. You could actually blast off pieces of a battle droid, like blast off his arm and actually see that shrapnel just shred apart the metal, see the circuitry and the wires being exposed and sparking underneath it. Or a super battle droid, you know, being a clone trooper, having a slug-firing shotgun that just fires slugs of pure energy, just big old bolts, and you fire a couple straight into the chest of the super battle droid in the same spot. The first shot kind of deflects right off, just leaves some burn marks. Second shot goes beyond the burn marks and actually sees some of the molten metal. It actually starts to melt a little bit. It starts to buckle underneath the pure energy of it. And then the third shot, see some fire, a little bit of grease coming out, just spurting like, you know, just little bits of fire. And the more you fire your slug energy shotgun, eventually the fire just gets out of control. It's just all consuming. It gets consistent, just a pure stream of fire just jutting out of it. And eventually, you know, the battle droid starts breaking down. It's harder to control for the player playing him, and then he just blows up, eventually spreading all kinds of body parts from those who battle droid in every direction. Meanwhile, this is going on with 200 players total, 100 clones, 100 CIS. Fuck! I hate that! They needed some sort of an entrance there. I was hoping I could go beyond that bush line, but it didn't work out that way. Yeah, that's what I want for the next Battlefront 2019-2020, something like that. 200 players, 100 on each team. You gotta have a big scale for Clone Wars. I don't know why somebody would want 32 versus 32 Clone Wars. How do you get Star Citizen? Well, if you want to get Star Citizen, right now it's in alpha, I'm going to say. Technically, I think it might be in beta, but I consider it to be an alpha. It's not released, so you got to remember it's currently in development. It's not going to be released for a few years, so if you buy it right now to play it, you gotta remember you're basically buying it to support the developers, support development, which is a great thing, but you're also buying it to make the game better. So you're going to be, you know, providing, there's going to be errors because it's not a finished product. It's like if the next big game, really big game that's to come out, you help with the development process and tell them what you want to be inside of it, what you think should be changed, what you think should be removed, stuff like that. But you can go to the Robert Space Industries website and you can pledge a pack that's as cheap as around like $30 or $25, and then when the game releases, you'll have it. Because there's some packages right now that if you pledge, you'll not only be able to play right now to give developments ideas and feedback, but also a ship and a full copy of the game upon its release, which is pretty exciting. I think that's really neat. Regardless, thank you for joining me for this live stream of Star Wars Battlefront. We discussed a lot of fun stuff, and this is the free weekend for Rogue One Scarif, so please download it, play it. As long as you own the base game, you can play it this weekend for free and experience the Battle of Scarif, the invasion of the beaches itself. And I hope you enjoyed discussing some Star Wars stuff. I enjoyed discussing Star Wars stuff with you. We'll do another Battlefront stream before too long, because even though we've played this game like hundreds of times now on stream, it's so fun talking about Star Wars with other people. And you guys are just the best people to talk about Star Wars with, because you love it as much as I do. And that's kind of, as weird as it sounds, with how popular Star Wars is, it's kind of hard to find. But I don't trust my internet that much, so I'm gonna stop it here. But I'm gonna do some shoutouts before we leave. And you know what? I think you guys want to see the shout-out challenge, so I'm going to do the shout-out challenge. If you're new to the fam, welcome. Shout-out challenge is as many shout-outs as I can do in one breath. This is going to be a collective effort. I'm going to need the help of you guys to do this and accomplish it and set it all up. But if you're new to the fam, welcome. If you enjoyed your time today, subscribe. Like the video if you want to see more. And everybody in the chat room, I need you to do something for me. Everybody would ask for a shout out, but don't like spam it. Ask for a shout out. Like, if everybody would, like, everybody ask for a shout out, that would be awesome. And spam it every 10 seconds. That would be perfect, actually. Because I try not to get repeat shout outs in too much. Try to get everybody as I can. Anyway, I'm gonna try doing a big deep breath for this. Okay. I think I'm ready. Let's do this. Vortex, Sam, DeBear, Sam, Gravstar, Ghostmasters, damn it, Sam! Three times in like a span of 5 seconds. I gotta start over. Thanks, Sam! Alright. Bella Logan, Chaotic, Jay Lee, Iman, Heiko, Adam, Lad Baseball, Freddy, Okasi, Star Wars Legacy, Jack Strickland, Max Fry, Nick Mecca, King Kaiju, Vortec, Alan R, Ball of Force, Max, Mr. Potato, Sam, Warpathmas, Darren Soames, Armin, Anime Nerd, Darren, Timothy, Luke, Jim, Robert, Anthony, Arakla, Metro Mod, Ender the TM, Taylor Henry, Ikenobi 75, Butchie Plays, James, Taylor, Paula, Aiden, Mighty Neptune, Taylor, Bruce, Scott, Painful! All right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 48 shoutouts in one breath. Not too shabby. That wasn't that bad. 10 more shoutouts! Shoutout to JLee32! Shoutout to Jim Raymond! Shoutout to Fearsome Lab Gaming! Shoutout to Taylor Henry, Mario and Luigi, Ramza! Shoutout to LukeMan10! Shoutout to Wizard Keegan Gaming! Shoutout to Scorchon33 and Stitch137ATM! Thank you for joining me for this latest Battlefront adventure! We'll have some more shoutouts very soon in the next stream, and next stream will probably be tomorrow. And if not, probably the day after that. Or at least the video tomorrow if there's no stream. But regardless, next stream is coming very soon. Until then, the Force will be with you. Always. Game massively, friends.